Forward into Ruth chapter 3. How many of you are there? Are you there? Just say, I'm here. All right, very good. Well, if you've been with us, it's been a little bit of time, about a week or so since we've been in Ruth on the Wednesday night with Pastor Tommy that was here last week. The family of Elimelech, they had gone to the area, the land of Moab, because there was a famine in the land of Israel. They lived in Bethlehem, and he takes his family, his two sons and his wife Naomi, and they go to a place where there is food, frankly. They go to a place to where there is no famine. And it's Elimelech, it's Naomi, it's Mahlon, and Chilion. Is the family that goes. And then ultimately, because they're in the land of Moab, their two boys end up marrying two Moabite women, one named Ruth and the other one named Orpah. I always get that wrong, but it's Orpah, O-R-P-A-H. And they're Gentiles. You know, they're Gentiles. They're in a Gentile land, and they are Gentiles of whom they marry. Well, long story short, what happens is Elimelech and the two sons, they die. We don't know why, but they die. They die. And I spoke about the fellowship of suffering in our first teaching about the three women and what they go through and everything. But the fact of the matter is they die, and the women are all left as widows. And so what happens is the three ladies, the mom-in-law, Naomi, says to the two daughter-in-laws, hey, just go back to your cities, or back to your families. Go back so you may rest. You may rest. And one says, okay, and the other one says, no, I'm going to go with you, and I'm going to be with you. In fact, I will worship your God, and I will love your people, and I will be buried in the place that you die. So what a commitment, and what a commitment and love Ruth had for her mother-in-law, Naomi. Well, now let's fast forward. They're in Bethlehem. They're back to Bethlehem. That's the city they left, and now they need to survive. The two widows have come back. They need to survive, and what happens is back in those days you had the ability through a social assistance program, not welfare as I've said before, but it's social assistance to where you're able to go to someone's field and glean from their harvesting. In fact, they were told specifically in the law that they were not to harvest the corners of the fields, to allow the others to glean from it and to pick up and work to gather their food. And that's why I call it a social assistance program, because they had to work for their food. It wasn't just all these piles of wheat or whatever it was, or corn or whatever, just laying here, and they just had to then just pick it up for themselves. No, they had to go out and they had to actually go and bend over, just like you see in the fields, and start picking and start gleaning from it. So it was very difficult work. And in that, Naomi was too old to be able to do that, and it was hot and whatnot. So Ruth is the one who goes out and does the gleaning. Well, right away, Boaz, this man Boaz, who owns the field, he's the one who sees her, and the Lord brings favor unto her through Boaz, and he says, listen, for this young woman, not only do you allow her to glean in all my fields, but don't have her go into any other fields, and then also I want you to kind of on purpose go, oops, I want you to drop some things, you know, and let her pick them up. And let her also not be around the young men, but have her be around the young women. And so that's where we're at this point. And as he notices her, we see that he really wants to take care of her. And the Lord brings and disposes her favorably in this land. Remember, she was a foreigner. She was a Gentile foreigner at that. And yet Boaz, who is pictured here as the kinsman redeemer, because he is, as we find out tonight, a kin of Elimelech, and because of that, there was also in the law the ability to redeem back in case someone, a brother or a family member, had passed away. And they then could marry that other person, the one young woman or woman, and then the name would be continued on. The name would last on. So there was provision in the law made for that as well. Well, let's go ahead and continue and begin at chapter 3, verse 1. It says this, "Then Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to her, 'My daughter, shall I not seek security for you that it may be well with you?'" You know, this thing that Naomi is speaking of, the mother-in-law, first thing you have to know here is the relationship. Remember, it's a mother-in-law and daughter-in-law relationship, but yet how does Naomi consider Ruth as a daughter? As a daughter, what a great relationship that is that the two of them had. And it was established back in chapter 1, as we read, in the commitment that Ruth had to Naomi. And so she says, listen, shall I not seek security for you? She wants to take care of her. She wants to make sure that she is well taken care of and that she doesn't go without. Now, as was prayed earlier, you know, this word security, I'm sorry, let's see here. Did I say so? Yes. This word security also means rest. And that's what we're looking at here. She's saying, you know, I want to provide a rest for you. I want to provide some peace for you. I want to provide security for you. Because gleaning in and of itself was not a good job security thing. You wouldn't have constant year, you know, month to month to month gleaning from this field and that field and that field, or you'd get sick or something would happen. You wouldn't be able to do it. And so, you know, it wasn't the best of livelihoods, and it could only be done during the harvest time. And so, of course, there was no real security with that kind of life. Well, Naomi knew. She knew about security. She knew about rest that Ruth would need. And the best way was that she would be married. That she would be married. So she makes this appeal, and now she suggests that Boaz be that individual, that man that she will marry. That word, as I said, security, means rest, as it's translated in the Hebrew. It's first mentioned to us in chapter 1, verse 9. "The Lord grant that you may find rest," it says. Here in this chapter, in chapter 3 now, we read the same word is used, and it's in the context of true rest or security. Now, when I think of security, and probably when you think of security, you think of some things. I'll tell you what I thought about when I think of security. I think of protection. That's what I think of, security. I think of protection against someone coming into my home. So you have a security alarm system, right? I think of security against someone taking advantage of you financially, so you might draw up a security agreement. Or maybe protection against falling short in something, whatever it might be, and that's where we get the name security blanket. It's that covering for you, that protection for you. So that's kind of how I equate the word security when we read about it or hear it in our English language. But the word security or rest in this context, it really means something else. It means peace. It means quietness. When you think of rest, I don't know what you think of, but I think of, man, just like sitting on my surfboard waiting for a wave. Now, to me, that is perfect rest because I am sitting there. No cell phones. There's no one knocking at my door. There's nothing I have to study for. There's nothing going on. I don't even think about you all when I'm sitting in the water. But I am sitting there on my board, and I am just sitting, chilling, and waiting for the next set. It's great. And I am resting. Whatever it is that brings you that same joy, that same rest, that same relaxation, just kind of put that in the blank. But that's what brings me rest, sitting out there, just kind of looking around and seeing what creatures are swimming around us even. So it's a lot of fun to do, but that brings me rest because it's peaceful for me. It's quiet. And maybe you see the occasional school of dolphin going out behind you, and you see their humps and this and that, and it is so restful and peaceful and quiet. And the point is I get refreshed. That's what rest does. It refreshes us. And that's what rest should equate or mean to you as well. Now, the security and this rest that Naomi speaks of, is she speaking in the context of her getting married. So she's speaking of the fact of a home life. And she's saying, listen, this, you will find security, you will find rest in a home, preferably your home, you see. I pray that's really what we should have as Christians, is rest, peace, quietness, a place to go and enjoy and relax would be our homes. A home is to be a place of security, no doubt about it. A place where you can go and kind of let your hair down a little bit, so they say, and be yourself and be secure in that home. Not only in the physical sense that you can lock doors, but be secure. And a home is also to be a place of rest. I pray that your homes are places of rest. It should be a place of rest. Because where God dwells, there will be rest. There will be peace. And that's one of the reasons why, as I said earlier, Gene and I, we have our home filled with worship music. We have it filled with the Word of God going out. You know, we happen to have had these old wireless speakers that we'll put here and put there, and we'll listen to teachings or again, we'll listen to music, worship music, and you're having peace. You're having the Lord dwell in your home, and you're being filled with all of those things, and that's really what a home should be. And that's why Naomi here says, you know, Ruth, you know, my daughter, shall I not seek rest for you? Shall I not seek security for you, that it may be well with you? You see? And your home and my home, as children of God, should be a place of peace, should be a place of rest, not a place of strife, and not a place of angst or anger or battle lines or whatever you might want to call it. No, our homes are intended to be a place of refuge. If your home is not a place of refuge today, then pray, for number one, that it would be. But number two, you should make it a point, you need to make it a point to understand God's plan and what He wants for your home to be like. He wants it to be a place of peace. He wants it to be a place of refuge that you can go to and feel safe and feel secure and have that quietness and stillness of heart, to where when you walk in your door, you're like, I'm home. When was the last time that you ever have done that? Maybe it was this morning, I don't know, or when you went home tonight. Praise the Lord, maybe, I'm home. Praise the Lord, I'm home. You know, that's what I like about my home, is that when I do get home, it's like, especially after a long missions trip or a time here or there to where I'm gone, and I'm like, oh, I get to come home, because it's so enjoyable and it's such a place, because I know that, you know what, I'll have peace there. And it's not the peace that I give or the peace that Gene gives, but it's the peace that God gives. That's the kind of peace I'm talking about. So pray for it. Make opportunity for the Word of God and the worship of God to be full in your homes. To be full in your homes. And so, verses 2 and 3, we go on to say, now Boaz, whose young women you were with, is he not a relative? So now she brings up Boaz. In fact, he is winnowing barley tonight at the threshing floor. Therefore, wash yourself and anoint yourself. Put on your best garment and go down to the threshing floor, but do not make yourself known to the man until he has finished eating and drinking. So Naomi knows Boaz is able to redeem Ruth. He knows, she knows, knowing that he's a close relative, because she told us back in chapter 2, verse 20, this man is a relation of ours, one of our close relatives. Now, if you have a King James Version, it would say kinsman. And so that's where we're going with this. We're speaking about this whole kinsman redeemer picture of Boaz. And so she says, hey, listen, whose young woman women you were with, is he not our relative? Is he not our kinsman? And so one of the things is this. In this we read she knows that he's the relative. She knows that he's a kinsman redeemer. But let me put it this way. She knows he's able. Okay? She knows he's able. She knows about his wealth. She knows about he's a godly man. She knows all these things. She knows he has the wherewithal to marry her. He's able, but the question is he willing? Is Boaz willing to take Ruth as his wife? So she sends Ruth to Boaz. She sends him to Boaz to see if he's going to be willing to accept her. This is an interesting portion of Scripture that we're going to talk about tonight, because it, to you and to me, it might sound kind of odd, kind of quirky a little bit. Why would she do this? But we're going to find that the reason why was because she needed to find out whether Boaz is willing, would be willing to accept her and take her as his wife. He's able, but is he willing? And I think about our kinsman redeemer. Oh, he's able, like Jesus, he's able, but is he willing? Well, of course he is. He showed how willing he was by his death on the cross, did he not? That's how willing he was. Yes, he was able, but was he willing? He showed his willingness by going on the cross and dying for you and for me. Verses 4 and 5, then it shall be when he lies down, you shall notice the place where he lies, and you shall go in, uncover his feet, and lie down, and he will tell you what you should do. And she said to her, all that you say to me, I will do. Well, back in those days, they would harvest the grain, three steps. They would harvest the grain, they would thresh the grain, and then they would winnow the grain. And the winnowing is kind of like a separating or a stepping on and so forth. It's not threshing, but it's kind of like lifting, you know, and so forth. And so that's, following that, what they do is they bag it. They bag it all together. They put it in bags. And so they put the bag in grains in sacks. And now remember, this time, what time are we in? We're in the time of the judges. And we know that in the time of the judges, there wasn't a lot of policing going on. And since there wasn't a lot of policing going on, well, there was a lot of robbery, a lot of robbers going on. So after all of this harvest, then we see that Boaz is actually down there guarding the harvest, guarding that of which they've worked so hard to grow and to yield that harvest. And so she instructs Ruth to go and go to the threshing floor, go where all that is. And this is going to be a way of communicating to Boaz that she's saying basically that I will be your wife. I will be your wife if you're interested in redeeming me. That's really what this whole thing is about. This is what she is doing by this act, by this action, by what she's demonstrated. Now, one of the things, as I see this for us in the New Testament, is that for you and for me, this should encourage us. As Ruth laid herself at the feet of Boaz by faith, at the instruction of her mother-in-law, Naomi, that you and I, this should encourage us to lay ourselves by faith at the feet of Jesus. Whatever it might be, whatever's going on, whatever it is you need, you have problems going on financially, you have problems going on in your marriage, you have problems going on in relationship, you have problems going on with your kids, you have problems, whatever it is, you need to have the faith to be able to lay ourselves at the feet of Jesus. Jesus is your kinsman redeemer. That's who he is. He took upon himself flesh, and even as in marriage, he is bone of our bone and flesh of our flesh. Do you understand me? See, and that's what Jesus has done. And so you and I are to, by faith, lay ourselves at the feet of Christ, just as we see Ruth doing here. This isn't some kind of a provocative, sexual type of gesture that's going on. Not by any stretch at all. Don't misinterpret it. Don't misunderstand that to be the case. Because this type of gesture was to be was understood in this way. In the culture of the time, the culture of that day, it was understood to be a gesture of submission. Understand that. A gesture of submission. In that day, it was understood to be the role of a servant. A servant would lie at the feet of his or her master, awaiting a command. It was a gesture of total, unequivocal submission to lay at the feet of your master. And so Naomi knew that by Ruth laying at the feet of Boaz, that this would be that act of total submission to him. See, that's why she's going out in faith, going to be laying at his feet, saying, I'm willing to marry you. I want to be your wife if you are willing to redeem me. See, and that's what we're talking about tonight. And so Naomi knew. She knew that by her doing that would be a total act of total submission. Understand, and don't misunderstand, that, you know, for Ruth, this was still within her right to claim to have the right to be taken care of. It was still within the law that she be taken care of by the kinsman, by the closest relative. It was within her right to demand that because it was ordained by the law. But she didn't. She went in humility. You know, many times you and I have the right to do something or not do something. But I say this to you, and I'll put this to you tonight, that maybe more so we should go by humility and not by right. And let God, trust God, put it at the feet of Christ by faith that that situation will be taken care of. Yeah, maybe you have the right, but is it right? Boaz was her Goel. He was her Goel, her kinsman redeemer, and she had the right to expect him to marry her. It was full within her rights. Yet the instructions of Naomi wasn't that she come demanding the right to be fulfilled, but trusting in the goodness of the kinsman redeemer, in the goodness of Boaz. Remember his name, strength, integrity, valor. The name totally speaks of who he is and what his character is as well. And by doing this act of humility, stay with me, by doing this act of humility, she says, I trust and accept you. I trust you and I accept you. And I put all of my trust of my fate into your hands, is what she's saying. By doing this one simple act. Everything I lay at your feet. And this is what we've done. This is what you and I have done in giving our respect and our trust and putting our whole lives into the hands of our kinsman redeemer, Jesus Christ. Is it not? That is what you and I have done. We have gone to him. We have come to him. We have accepted him into our lives and saying, Lord, I am your vessel. I am willing. I want you to do with me as you please. You trust him. You put everything at his feet and say, how many times, maybe some of you have heard me say, you know what? Hey, you just need to lay that thing down at the feet of Christ. You just need to lay that at the cross It's the same thing. You got to lay those things at the cross. You're laying your life at the cross of Christ. You being your redeemer, your relative, your kinsman, and you're saying, Lord, you know, I trust you for my life. So if you trust him for your life, then why do we not hear him? Why do we not listen to him? Why do we not follow his commands? Why are we not obedient to him? Why do we not repent? Why are we not submitted to one another in love? Why? You see, if you truly put your trust in Christ, then you will truly do all that he asks of you and requires. You and I, we take this role of submission and we abide in whatever the Master decides for us. Whatever he wants for you, whatever he tells you to do, whether you like it or not, you have to abide. It's that marriage relationship that where Jesus provides godly leadership, where Jesus provides godly care, where Jesus provides godly concern for his bride, and that's you and me. We are his bride. He is the groom. He is our redeemer. He is our kinsman, and he loves us so much. And so we put our faith and our trust and our lives in his hands, and we say, Lord, I will follow you. Lord, you are my master, and I will do whatever you've asked me to do, regardless of the cost, regardless of the cost, because I know that you have care and concern and that you love me, and so therefore you want to lead me. That's a picture of a husband in his home. Godly leadership, godly care, godly concern. We'll talk about that the next go around as we go into Ruth. But Ruth wisely receives counsel from Naomi, knowing that she knows that the counsel of her mother-in-law would be good. Verses 6 and 7. So she went down to the threshing floor and did according to all her mother-in-law instructed her. And after Boaz had eaten and drunk, and his heart was cheerful, he went to lie down at the end of the heap of grain, and she came softly, uncovered his feet, and lay down. This is such a good time. Harvest time. Oh man, all the hard work has been done. You see the fruits of your labor. You see all the grain, or you see all of that harvest, and it's time to rejoice and time to have a great, great time with everyone around you and have a great feast and enjoying the fruits of their labor. She comes and she lies down at his feet. There's two things I see here. Number one, she's obedient. She does exactly as Naomi has instructed her. Exactly. Let me read you two quotes here. Because we're talking about Ruth, who's younger, and Naomi, who's older. So she's taking instruction from the elder. Many times, young people these days don't want to take instruction from the elder. They don't want to take instruction from their moms and dads. They don't want to take instruction from those who are in authority. And so, because they don't think they know enough. Or you don't know what I'm about, you don't know what's going on in my life, or you can't tell me what to do, or I'm not going to listen to you, plain and simple. Let me cite to you a couple of quotes from Charles Spurgeon. He says this: young people, you must pray, for your passions are strong and your wisdom is little. Good quote. Another one is, here's one that I thought it was like really, really true. Your armor, young men, or you could say young women, though it glistens and in the sunlight looks like silver, affords you no ground for boasting. For if sin had not made you weak, you would have required no armor whatsoever. You see, if in fact what Charles Spurgeon says is that if you truly, truly, if sin had not made you weak, if sin had not caused you to fall, gosh, you would not even need this armor. But we need the armor of God. Ruth does exactly as her mom, her mother-in-law, instructs her to do. The second thing I see is what confidence Ruth has that she will not be rejected by Boaz. Oh, she walks in with a confidence and a trust based on her mother-in-law and what she has instructed her to do, and she goes in exactly like she is instructed, in humility and quietness. And after he's done the feasting and everything, and he's asleep, and she goes in with a confidence that she will not be rejected by Boaz. Hebrews 4:16 tells us this: let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Hebrews 4:16 says, let us therefore come boldly. Wonderful. No need to fear. Romans 3:18, there is no fear of God before their eyes. We're not to fear the Lord. 1 John 4:18, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love, meaning you don't understand the love of God. And so we see these two things. She does exactly as Naomi has instructed, and she goes in confidence to Boaz. Verses 8 and 9. Now it happened at midnight that the man was startled. Of course he'd be startled. And turned himself, and there a woman was lying at his feet. You know, he was expecting probably robbers, right? But then there's this whatever is going on, and he wakes up at midnight, and all of a sudden he finds out it's a woman lying at his feet. And he said, who are you? And so she answered, I am Ruth, your maidservant. Take your maidservant under your wing, for you are a close relative. Boom, to Boaz, she says, I'll marry you, she tells him. She says, I'll marry you. Remember, she's a widow too. She's a widow. And so culturally, what we're saying here, when she says this, take your maidservant under your wing in verse 9, for you are a close relative, it's the same thing as saying, spread the corner of your garment over your maidservant. And it was a cultural thing that they did, to where even today when a Jewish man marries a woman, he throws a skirt or garment, the end of his garment, over her to show that he's taken her under his protection. Isn't that neat? They even do that today. God uses the same words in relation to Israel and to us. You and me. Ezekiel 16:8, when I passed by you again and looked at you, indeed your time was a time of love. So I spread my wing over you and covered your nakedness. Yes, I swore an oath to you and entered into a covenant with you, and you became mine, says the Lord God. See, he's covered us. He protects us. He gives us security. Therefore, he gives us that rest. Verses 10 through 12. Then he said, blessed are you, O Lord, my daughter, for you have shown me more kindness at the end than at the beginning, in that you did not go after young men, whether poor or rich. And now, my daughter, do not fear. I will do for you all that you request, for all the people of my town know that you are a virtuous woman. Verse 12, now it is true that I am a close relative. However, there is a relative closer than I. All right. This probably now tells us, and we just read that, why Boaz really didn't pursue Ruth as the kinsman redeemer to redeem back the land of Naomi or to marry Ruth. He didn't go after her so with fervor or pursue her, because he says here, hey, there is a relative closer than I. So that closest relative had to be that redeemer. But another thing you need to note here is that Boaz, he's so blessed by her because he says, you did not go after the young men. Boaz was an older guy. He wasn't a young guy. He was an older guy. And he says, you know, whether poor or rich, you didn't go after the young men. It's kind of like, hey, you know, gee, you like this old guy? Wonderful, wonderful, you know? And so he's blessed by that. And he could have, but didn't, force himself upon her. He doesn't act as a goel, as a kinsman redeemer, until she desires it, until she asks it of him. And notice what he says about her, her character. He says, for all the people of my town know that you are a virtuous woman. What a reputation to have, to be known as a virtuous woman. Now, He not only saw that she was beautiful on the outside, but what he was so most taken by was her beauty on the inside and the strength of her character. He saw that in her. That word virtuous basically is meaning strength, moral strength, good quality, integrity, and virtue. It says a lot. It says a lot for Ruth. And in verse 12, we see that Boaz was honorable and he had integrity. He wasn't about to cut corners or pull an end run and go and marry her without doing what was right. Remember, he's a man of integrity himself, a man of character, a man of valor. So remember that. It's very important. Verses 13 and 14. Stay this night, and in the morning it shall be that if we will perform the duty of a close relative for you, good. Let him do it. But if he does not want to perform the duty for you, then I will perform the duty for you as the Lord lives. See? It's as the Lord lives. It's like, that's a promise. As God is living, as God is active, guess what? I will do this duty to you. Lie down until morning. So she lay at his feet until morning. She rose before one could recognize another. And it was still dark. Then he said, do not let it be known that this woman came to the threshing floor. So it's cool, it's great that he's concerned about a reputation. He doesn't want a reputation to be soiled or tarnished. Verses 15 through 18. Also he said, bring the shawl that is on you and hold it. And when she held it, he measured 6 ephahs of barley and laid it on her. Then she went to the city. When she came to her mother-in-law, she said, is that you, my daughter? Then she told her all the man had done for her. And she said, these 6 ephahs of barley he gave me. And he said to me, do not go empty-handed to your mother-in-law. What a gentleman, huh? Then he said, trying to make points with Naomi, I'm thinking. Then she said, sit still, my daughter, until you know how the matter will turn out. For the man will not rest until he has concluded the matter this day. Man, does she know guys, huh? Naomi knows men. She goes, listen, he's already got his sights on you. He's already loves you. He's already committed to you. And she told her everything that he had done, probably what he had said even, as the Lord lives, I'll perform this duty for you. So she says, hey, listen, sit back. Rest right now. Let the Lord work things out, because if what he says comes to pass, guess what? The matter will be concluded this very day. Verse 18, I believe, sums it up truly for all of us. What Naomi is speaking to Ruth about is trust in the Lord. Trust in the Lord. She says, sit still until you know how the matter will turn out. And as children of God, you and I, We're to rest. We're to trust. Sit still in matters where the Lord wants to show himself faithful and powerful. Is there something in your life going on that you want to just kind of move things around yourself, or you're fretting about, or you're caring about way too much? Well, you know what? Take the advice of a wise woman named Naomi. Sit still. Sit still. Let God show his faithfulness. Let God show his power. And you and I, as children of God, as his children, we're to cast our cares on him. Not worry about them ourselves. Not try and take care of them ourselves. Because God has promised that he would take care of your cares for you. And what need do we have to care about? Whatever his will is going to happen. Whatever his will. You know, is there something in your life tonight going on? Is there a matter in your life tonight? Well, the words to you and me this evening is to sit still. Sit still and trust God and see how it's going to fall into place according to the perfect will of God. Because believe you and me, when we put our hands in the mix, man, don't we mess things up? We really mess things up. And his perfect will make it... will make his word good to you. It really will. Let me end with these verses as encouragement. Psalm 37:3. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and feed on his faithfulness. Psalm 37:4. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Trust also in him, and he shall bring to pass. Verse 5, commit your way to the Lord. Verse 6, he shall bring forth your righteousness as the light and your justice as the noonday. Verse 7, rest in the Lord and will patient and wait patiently for him. Do not fret because of him who prospers in his way, because of the man who brings wicked schemes to pass. Verse 8, cease from anger, forsake wrath. Do not fret, it only causes harm. Verse 9, for evildoers shall be cut off, but those who wait on the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. In Psalm 37, 3 through 9, it says, trust in the Lord, delight in the Lord, trust to him again, commit your way to him, shows his faithfulness, what he's going to bring to you. Then it says rest, and it says wait patiently. Don't fret about it, he says. Those who wait, they shall inherit the earth. I think those are good words to live by. And I think we can all do a much better job living by those words, trusting in God, waiting on his providence, waiting on what he wants to do in your life. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this time of study. I thank you, Lord, that we are here this evening and we get to glean as Ruth gleaned from the field of Boaz. We get to glean from your field here tonight, God. And that, Lord, may we be strengthened. May we learn how to walk in that humility. May we learn how to receive direction and instruction in righteousness, Lord. And Lord, may we also just learn to trust you. May we learn to trust you, Lord, in all things and in all ways, no matter what the situation, no matter what the issue is, may we walk by faith. As Ruth walked by faith and entered in to that threshing floor where Boaz was, and by faith she laid herself down at his feet. Lord, may we by faith lay things down at your feet. May we by faith lay things down at the cross, knowing that you will take care of those things that have much care on our hearts, that we think about, that we dwell upon. Lord, no matter what the situation is, no matter what's going on in my family, no matter what's going on in the families represented here, Lord, we need to sit and wait for you to be able to play out your perfect will for our lives. And so, God, I pray that for each and every one here, that we learn the lessons of Ruth to wait patiently. And so, God, we love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen, you guys.